The Who started as a band with four very different individuals with very, very different needs. Got a few hits, managed to pull off Tommy, managed to pull off some kind of amazing live stage energy.
The TUC conference in London has voted for militant action
and protest against the burdens created by the oil crisis.
As the gas situation gets worse, according to
the miners, need now some inducement.
I think the 3-day week should be called off at once.
10 years on from The Who's first successes comes the release this weekend of a new double album that could be a step on even from Tommy, Quadrophenia.
So when we got to Quadrophenia, talking 1973, something strange was happening to the internal politics of the band. It was quite clear that Keith Moon was certifiably insane, and that if he hadn't had a drum kit to play with, he probably would have ended up in jail. John Entwistle just simply wasn't happy because he was a songwriter, and it seemed as though for him the band had become all about me and my ideas. Roger wanted something which would mean that he could swing his hair and look glamorous and take his chest off and be a superstar. I had difficulties as well. Lifehouse, which followed Tommy, failed. The accusation was, you failed with your big idea because, you know, you're arty-farty, pretentious twat. It felt to me as though we were drifting apart. So my first mission, my first part of the brief that I gave myself was replace Tommy as a performing vehicle. That was it. So my story was, I bought this riverside property out, it's actually a place called Cleve, or Cleve Lock on the River Thames, and one day I got this call about Eric, was wallowing in down in his house in the country, and would I go down and see Eric? Eric had done an album and ended up as a heroin user. I remember going down to see him. He was very courteous, very kind, very dignified, very loving, very friendly, as he always was to me. But I was affected by it. I start to think about how we can, not rescue Eric, but just to kind of stimulate him, turn to a couple of my mates, Ronnie Wood, Stevie Winwood, and we came here to this house to rehearse. And we were in the room over there and we all gathered together. I was nodding off and Rick Gretsch, the bass player, said, try this. And I said, what is it? He said, oh, it's a kind of a popper thing. He said, it wakes you up. And it was amyl nitrate. And I took it and I went, oh, that's fun. You know, I did a little bit of a buzz and then played. And I didn't get stuck on it, but I used it quite a bit. Once the concert with Eric in January 1973 was over, I suppose I must have had some sort of come down from the lack of amyl nitrate. On a dark, wet winter weekend at the cottage at Cleve, with the river running faster than usual, I had a flashback to when I was 19 years old. The Who just played this amazing gig at the Aquarium Ballroom in Brighton, and I was with my art school friend, Liz Reed. After the gig, we missed the train home, so we hung out and we went down under the pier, and there were all these boys in parkas with the fucking tide coming up around their feet. They didn't seem to understand that they were going to drown. Under the pier, I was coming down from taking Purple Hearts, the fashionable uppers of the period. Sitting there at Cleve that day 9 years later, the same feeling came flooding back, of feeling depressed, lost and hopeless, and I grabbed a notebook. And quickly, while I was still in this sad and lonely mood, I scribbled out the story that is on the inside sleeve of the original album of Quadrophenia. This was the story of a mod called Jimmy. Jimmy was a normal boy with normal needs going, passing through the normal things of childhood. But what made everything so much more complicated for him was that he had a bipolar problem. You know, he was schizophrenic.
I think that Jimmy is meant to be, instead of schizophrenic, he's meant to be quadrophrenic. And that's the original concept, to have Jimmy have these four personalities.
So Quadrophenia is a double album, you know, in the old days of vinyl. That meant, you know, you had two 12-inch vinyl discs. And it's that difficult, dodgy 70s thing, the concept album. You know, this sensitive story of a mod on a journey of self-discovery, but played by The Who. Tough, muscular, physical, a man's band.
What I know is that I'm going to be on a stage with a bunch of yobbos with an electric guitar. I'm going to have to turn it up. I'm going to have to jump up and down. I'm going to have to snap. I'm going to have to tell them to fuck off and shut up. This is Pete, the writer, trying to serve Keith and John and Roger, giving them really stimulating, useful fucking stuff that they could express their stage personalities through.
The Who sound has got those warring elements in it. On the one hand, they're a street-fighting band, doing all that physical, visceral side on the one hand. On the other hand, that spiritual, whimsical, melancholic, lyrical side, and banging them together, often in one song.
This bit of paper is kind of, on the top line you've got me, Roger, John, Keith. The next line is good, bad, romance, and they're joined together with the word sex, insanity. And then the idea that each of these themes would produce songs. In actual fact, this is just a musical blueprint for what I wanted to do.
Pete, you know, you're working very hard. I don't know quite what on. But, I think it'll be good.
The trouble is with Pete, he's got these... working with him was he'd have these wonderful little kernels of ideas, but then he'd want to pitch them and make them into stories. But we got the essence of it. This guy's got all the personalities of every member of the band, and it's just about this one guy. And that was enough for me to say, look, great idea, let's go for it.
This is how the album starts. Okay.
No other Who album starts with ambient noise. And it very specifically is putting you in a place. It sets a scene, which none of the other Who albums did.
Once we had the sea noise going, we just introduced each theme of the four themes.
First thing that you hear is, I am the sea. You hear the breathy sound of, I am the sea. And which is the helpless dancer. Then you hear, is it me for a moment, which is the romantic side, and so on. Is it me for a moment?
Instead of having a straight overture, you get pieces of the songs, and it comes back as memories. You're automatically put on that rock.
And you hear the themes, and then bang into the first track, which is Can You See the Real Me?
Can you see the real me? Can you? Can you?
He's at the doctor, he's going to the shrink, he's going to the priest, he's going to his mother for advice. And I wanted to establish very, very quickly that this is not just a troubled boy, this is a boy that has mental illness. You know, he's bipolar, he's manic depressive, he has... And this idea of him being, you know, doubly schizophrenic. Once you hear that track, you know that this is going to be the revelation of a condition. Jimmy gets up in the morning, goes to see his shrink, goes to see his priest because his mum's a deep, dark Catholic, you know, goes and looks up at this girl's bedroom that he's in love with and who won't shag him. Going right inside the boy's head, you know where you are, you've come from the peace of the sea, and the idea, this is a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and then bang, you're into the action.
It's in this yellow house. Yesterday she passed me by. She doesn't wanna know me now.
When I first heard it, a friend of mine had it, and they had the gatefold sleeve and everything, and I loved it, but it was quite costly. So they recorded it for me on a, what was back then, I think a C90. And I remember for ages thinking that he'd started on side two, because it begins with, I went back to the doctor. It's like you've jumped right into the middle of the stream. It's like you've come right into the middle of a riot. You've come right into the middle of a rush. And that is brilliant.
Can you see the real me, mama? Can you see the real me, 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 me?
One, two, three, four.
Pete decided that as part of the album, he'd have this lavish, very generous, big photo book to sort of illustrate the story. And also, the other thing is, I think he thought it would help explain the story, particularly to the Americans who didn't understand it.
Ethan Russell's photos put you in that place. As an American, you were able to understand it because you were able to see it. You were able to see his room. You saw the life. And told you the story better than a movie, better than a video. It's all there.
The first cover I did for The Who was the album Who's Next here. I was back in the United States. I got a call from Pete. He was pretty stressed already, because he'd been working on this forever, and you could feel this tremendous energy of him sort of wanting to birth this thing, you know. So he played me the material and told me the story. And we went out to try and sort of build that world.
We're here in Battersea in the Patmore estate. My sister Maxine and I used to live across the road here in this block of flats here. Our foster sister, Jane, used to live in this block of flats here, and the three of us used to hang out generally around on that corner block there. Along here, which used to be a church hall, became Ramport Studios, which was owned by The Who back in the early 70s. This is myself here. I would have been just coming up to probably just 15. That was apparently an original mod outfit. I have my hair cut very short and cropped and black eyeliner, which obviously you can't see through the black and white picture.
That's me. And I've got on a pencil skirt, pinstripe pencil skirt, hush puppy shoes, and a navy blue twin set, a little jumper underneath, cardigan. And like Judy, my haircut, very short, mod style haircut.
The girls came up. Too young to go in the pub, but they knew that I was looking for someone to play Jimmy.
Well, Chad was one of the local guys that lived near the pub. We thought he had the look for the main character in Quadrophenia, so we introduced him to Georgiana.
I saw the attitude. I saw the class and the attitude and the sort of, that his wheels were spinning a bit, you know?
And he was the real thing. He had love, hate tattooed on his hands, which is pretty early on in life for that, you know?
He was often in bed They'd have to go and get him, knock at the flat. I remember because he'd had too much to drink or maybe drugs. I don't know what. I won't swear that either. But he was often not on location when he's supposed to be.
About two-thirds of the way through the shoot, Chad came up to me and says, I got to go to court. And I said, well, what do you got to go to court for? And he said, I stole a bus. And I said, you stole a bus? And he said, yeah, I stole a bus. And I said, okay. He walks up to the judge, and the judge says, what'd you do? I said, oh, I took her for a drive. You know, I can't do the accent. And he says, well, what are you doing now? He says, I'm a male model. and I'm sitting in the back. He says, yeah, who do you work for? I work for the OO. And the judge turns to me and says, is this true? And I said, yeah. He says, do you need him? And I said, yeah, absolutely need him. So he let him off.
Had this thing about mods, even before they were mods.
I like to be subsumed in a gang. And so I love that feeling of being safe in the mod movement. You know, I felt safer in a gang of mods than I did in the band, I can tell you that.
There was this hierarchical structure. At the top, you'd have these top faces. These are the mods that really looked really smart and seemed to be able to afford new suits a lot. There was the numbers and there was tickets. The tickets were the little kids. The one I came across was 7 and 6s, and I never knew why they were called 7 and 6s. And it was because the T-shirts they wore were 7 and 6 in Woolworths.
What will the well-dressed mod be wearing this Whit weekend?
He'll either be wearing a white tee hipster slacks or blue hipster slacks. With either a cycling shirt, which is a zip here and black stripes across there, mainly with white ground or a blue ground, or on the other hand, be wearing a T-shirt with a large emblem on front or on back.
Roger always talks about the mod movement only happening because in those days, 62, 63, 64, a young man could get a job.
And we were the first generation to have money and creative energy. Because previous to that, everybody had been just slaving to pay the bloody bills and living on their ration book.
To be a face, you had to be going out to work. You know, you couldn't be a face if you were a school kid because you didn't have enough money to get out to wear the clothes, to buy the scooter, to pay for the petrol, to pay for the girlfriends and the burgers and the drinks.
The mods were hard-working youngsters, and it was all about spending your money on clothes.
A new booming outfitting business both meets and creates the mod demand for elegance in a young man. This shop now has 18 branches in London and a turnover of £500,000 a year.
They'd see Italian students and kids over here on holiday, in central London, and were just admiring their clothes and saying, look at the cut on their clothes, you know, stuff that we didn't have.
It's a colour suit, isn't it? I don't like
that
anyway.
From all these different elements emerged this sort of movement with its kind of very strict rules that were never written down, but they all seem to understand them.
It's a very mod neck, no. No? No, Rolex all right, it's got a suede front, isn't it? It's different.
Yeah, it's true, yeah.
This is great, I like it.
Oh, it's fabulous.
If I left a deposit for that, John, can I come back next week?
Yes, certainly.
Is that OK?
Yeah.
If you saw, say, a teddy boy, you'd know he was a teddy boy. But if you saw a mod, your mods could go and work in an advertising agency. No one would know they were mods because they just looked like a neat kid. But to other mods, they gave all the signals.
Maybe a slightly effeminate kid, and that was where I thought the real courage came.
They used to do their own sewing and stuff. Yeah. You know what I mean? They in these great big guys would say, I'll take in those trousers, I'll just take them on the old boys.
Well, they Roger weren't... made drain pipes and he put the zips in himself. He put zips in drain pipes.
But it was perfect because for the first time in generations, you dressed as you wanted to. And at work, you were probably
get away with it.
A shipping clerk or a filing clerk, You were management material. And you got sort of, oh, he's a very tidy young man. He's going up the ladder, mate.
Mugs have real strict taste rules, and it was difficult in a way to know what was in and what was out. I mean, I remember people talking to me about the way to stand outside the scene club. You'd have to stand in some way with your pocket, hand in your pocket, one in the other. It's all these sort of ways to maintain your cool.
My hair was a disaster. I hated it because when I looked in the mirror, I saw somebody like Art Garfunkel.
Roger had exactly the same problem, didn't he? I mean, he was constantly straightening his hair.
Dippity-doo.
He found this American gel that would straighten your hair long enough to get through a gig.
And I think the main driving force then was fashion. But then came the music bit and all the other thing. And the other thing was, you've got to put it in a context of the time. It was like people identifying with this new, modern, clean world.
This is Cut My Hair. It's like the first proper song on the album.
The album should have started with Cut My Hair, because that's where the story starts.
Yeah, on Cut My Hair, you've got this piano part, very kind of nursery, gentle piano, against which you get the story of the boy complaining about why he has to fuck around with his hair, basically, you know.
If I have to cut my hair, I got to move with the fashion or be outcast.
It's interesting because what it's about is a mixture of that refrain that we used to get when we were young and our hair was long, which was, get your hair cut. And suddenly all of that being turned on its head by the mod movement, where a face would turn to you and say, get your hair cut. And you'd think, hold on a minute, you know, you're only 3 or 4 years older than me, don't fucking tell me to get my hair cut, you know. Speed again, and I'm leaping along. Just right for a beach fight, but I just can't explain why that uncertain feeling is still here in my brain.
If you're raised in a mod neighborhood, then you have to fit in with those people. So we all sat down and had a haircut, which I hated. I mean, it had taken me nearly a year to grow my beetle fringe down to here, and then you were taken to this guy called Jack the Barber, more like Sweeney Todd. I remember going back to my house with Keith Moon and smashing the mirror in my room because I hated it. Yeah, horrible, horrible, horrible. I kind of rebelled against it, went out and bought myself a jacket and the trousers and the nice stuff, and I felt okay about it, except for my hair.
Zoot, zoot, white jacket was side, bent 5 inches long.
My initial reaction to it was, it's about me. The essence of Townshend's writing is that he writes about the adolescent problems and they never change. And that's why if you take away the mod tunic, the mod uniform, what you're left with is the universal adolescent problem.
What's happening at the very end is he's just thinking, this is shit. He can't deal with it. And then at the end you get this abject self-pity, which Jimmy falls into regularly, this sense of, you know, I can't do this.
We have the same old route.
So it sets up this thing that's starting at the beginning of Quadrophenia, that he's becoming disenchanted with the burden of being a mod, of trying to fit in, of having the right shoes, the right shirt, you know. He's not getting what he wants.
It's all a game, and inside I'm just the same. My Friday makes me sick first thing in the morning.
Youths entered the Grand Hotel in pursuit of two leather-clad rockers. South Coast police have warned that if the fights between rival gangs of mods and rockers continue, stricter security measures will be enforced at railway stations both in London and on the south coast.
Brighton was just one of those places that was popping.
Ah, well, say, like me and my friends, we went to a dance hall once, and there was a load of rockers there. We started dancing, just started taking the mick out of us. We can't just stand there and let a load of kids take the mick out of you, can you?
So what are you doing?
Well, you're going to have a punch up about it.
What do you fight with?
A fist.
The first trouble was in Clacton, and then afterwards, I think, Margate or whatever, and then it was Brighton. You'd have about 30 little mods versus three big rockers, you know, and all running up to go, come on then, and all this stuff, all posing and stuff like that.
It's the rockers that start it, you know, they screw you, and you, if you
what
take
screw
you,
me?
You know, look you up and down and think, it's a funny way of dressing yourself, think you're a puff or something like that.
The really cool mods hated the fact that there'd been this violence on the beach. They hated it. Bunch of wankers, you know, going and fighting with rockers. Huh. You know, that kind of thing, you know.
As I was laying in a hospital bed, a dumb old nurse went to my head. She said, hold up to all.
The beat they dance to is another difference between mods and rockers. At this mod club, the Chez Don, in the East End of London, the rhythm is blue and almost strong enough to lean against. The mod girls dance with each other, and no one bothers to talk, since you can't hear yourself speak. Rockers don't show their faces here. It would only lead to trouble.
This is the famous Gold Hawk Club. I'm opening the door to the dance hall. Along here, and on the other side, was a whole bunch of settees where a lot of necking went on. And there was kissing and French kissing and tongues and stuff.
We'd just done Ready, Steady, Go. They'd all been there in the audience with the crowd. We went to the Gold Hawk Club. We played Can't Explain. We played it again. We played it again. We played it again.
And I thought, God almighty, what's going on? The Who are playing one of my, probably my favourite song of all time. They played I Can't Explain three times. What's going on?
When I feel blue, can't you play?
Play it again, da, 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 da. You know, it's fucking glorious night at the Gold Hawk Club that their boys, you know, had gone on Ready, Steady, Go, which was the big mod program of the day.
I sort of elected myself as some kind of delegate, and I came here. I knocked on this door, this very door we're looking at.
Irish Jack walks forward and he says, "There's something we want to tell you."
And I said, "Look. This song is exactly what we're trying to say. You've said it for us. I can't explain because this is what mods were about. They couldn't explain. None of us could explain. We didn't have the articulation."
So I said to him, quite patronisingly, I said, "So Jack, you want me to write more songs for you about the fact that you can't explain what it is that you want me to explain and I can't explain what it is that you want to explain?" Jack immediately goes, "That's it!"
So in words, Pete Townshend became the song laureate of the Mods and Shepherd's Bush, Hammersmith, Acton, Ealing.
There's a fabulous postcard. We're about 18, 19. We look like perfect little girly mods. That's the band that Jimmy looked at and kind of went, "That's me." Then he goes into that band and finds that these four people, each one of them is a deeply eccentric and complex and difficult and fucked up individual, and they're each in their own way.
I'm the guy in the sky, right behind, flashing eyes, no surprise, I'm the
All those youth movements are built on false idols. They're all built on the idea of loving something and then, you know, that thing that never meet your idols. There's that crushing sense of disappointment. They're not the people that you think they are.
This was the only time the Who were in the entire book. We shot about 4 a.m. in the morning so we wouldn't have any traffic, and it was they would play the Hammersmith Odeon. That was the idea. And it's where, in the story, it's where Jimmy sees the Who. Otherwise, they don't intersect in the story. He's feeling inferior. His hero scooter is bust, and these guys have a limo.
There's this idea of the Who had these kind of mod roots, and they later became a kind of great big bloated rock band. And this, the distance between them being sort of, you know, almost 70s rock stars and the 60s roots of what they were, I think is played up in this photograph. You get this image of Jimmy, the mod, from the 1960s, clearly, down on one knee. And out here is the band coming out of the Hammersmith Odeon. But the band appear to be like a sort of 70s rock band. And the interesting thing is, it's that thing about, it's the distance between him and them. That's the time shift. This is when the album's being recorded. This is when it's about, and it's the distance between these two things that's important. I'm a guy in the sky, flying high, flashing eyes, no
surprise, I told lies, I'm a fucking doctor. He just happens to pass his ex-heroes, the Who, and just says to them, you bunch of, you fucking let me down. That's all it's about, and this one song, Punk and the Godfather, that was it.
Records traditionally have tracks with gaps in between them. What Quadrophenia has is a soundscape. And the thing that the soundscape of Quadrophenia is closest to is it's a film soundtrack. So between the tracks, you get the sound of Jimmy's life. Losing his bike, losing his dirty job, living rough on the streets, alone.
The sound of a train in a station, you know, the whistle. You know, the boiling kettle and the fried egg. In a sense, it's using sound as music. For Seeing Sand, for example, I just literally walked down a beach with a stereo mic singing Seeing Sand, you know, here by the sea and sand. But Quadrophenia had a sound. It was one sound from start to finish, and that sound was the sound of the backing track.
When that happened, the Who couldn't find a studio that they liked. So they said, right, let's buy a place and build our own, because they had some money then. So they found this church in Battersea, in Thessaly Road, Battersea.
Thessaly Road was really a storage facility. Pete Townshend came down one day to see where all his guitars were. Blimey. I'm surprised how spacious it is. He looked around, he gave a click of his fingers and he said, this has got good resonance. It had it's still got quite a bright sound in here. You know, slightly, but it was brighter than this. It was quite a bright, and that was unusual at the time. You know, most studios in London were a little bit deader than this one. He said, this will make a bloody good studio. So good. Right,
turn it into a studio.
There's a window you can see here, just there, which would have allowed you to see from this room, if you were sitting down, you could see into the control room, which would have been there, where the doctor's waiting room is. The main intention was that the control room should be quadrophonic. There were no rooms in the UK or in America at the time that had four speakers, one in each corner. There just weren't any. This is an acoustic ceiling designed, they're always designed like this with this dish. And you can see that that would have been one of the plinths on which we hung one of the quadrophonic speakers, another one there, another one there. You can see that the room is designed in a quadrophonic shape. The mixing desk would have been here, tape machines there. I had the idea to do something in quadrophonic before I was certain about the story of Quadrophenia. And the band that were doing the most experimentation with it were Pink Floyd. And they'd done a couple of shows where they'd introduced quadrophonic sound into their live shows. Money, dun, 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 chicken, would come out in the back right, you know, this great big chink, and then it would come out there, and then it goes round and round and round. It was very exciting.
So we had a test unit sent over, and Pete hated it. The separation wasn't, it was like a big mono. And Pete said, you know, I am not going to make a quadrophonic album that sounds worse than the stereo.
These days on a computer, you could do this kind of thing in 15 seconds. Back then, it was much harder.
We actually never mixed anything in quadrophonic. Quadrophenia is strictly a stereo album.
At the same time as trying to do that, everything was up in the air. They were building a studio and trying to record this thing in the studio while there were builders in there. I mean, and there's people under the desk, screwing, undoing things. It's just, well, hold on a minute, another take, and then they start. It was utter chaos.
What was different about our studio to everybody else is that we had the bar in the fucking studio. You know, you kind of go, pour yourself a pint of beer or a pint of brandy, whatever it was, right there. You didn't have to reach out very far. The average Who session, not for Roger, but for John, Keith and I, would start, we'd roll up, you know, it'd be 2 o'clock. By 4 o'clock, we would have had enough brandy to start fiddling around, you know, and that would, you know, we would be telling stories. Roger hated all that stuff. He just thought it was time-wasting.
We were building around the making of Quadrophenia, and we didn't know our arse from our elbow. We didn't know what we were doing.
When the desk did get put in, Pete's out there, let's see what it sounds like. And all of us in the control room, our ears and noses started to bleed. I have a ruptured eardrum to this day because of it.
We measured it. It was louder than standing by the four engines of Concorde at full throttle.
It was 140 decibels. And it just, one guitar blast, just projectile bleeding.
As well as the studio falling apart, Townshend was in danger of losing his long-term creative ally and producer. By the start of Quadrophenia, Townshend was still under the illusion that Kit Lambert was going to be around to help him.
Kit Lambert and Chris Stamp, their co-managers, got into heroin and stuff. So they were kind of not looking after business, or so Roger thought, because Roger found out that all the money hadn't been accounted for and there was some money missing.
That was a really sad period, actually. Kit still wanted to be the producer as such.
Kit Lambert, who had supposed to have been co-producing with me, had stopped coming. I took him out, and in the end, I got so angry with Kit over his behaviour that I started to threaten him physically. And funnily enough, Roger came out and calmed me down and got Kit Lambert away, and then we never really worked together again.
And Daddy was long gone. Townshend was on his own.
It was pretty difficult. I didn't realise the extent of their drug use. And I didn't realise just how much destructive behaviour was going on. And I guess that Pete felt incredible pressure.
the local community were really good to us. They loved having the Who there. And that was in the days when, you know, the power station was working.
You know, we had kids from the estate used to come in and sit down in the front sometimes.
5:15 was one of the songs that they let us listen to, which was exciting. Roger would say things like, girls, would you buy this song? We'd either say yes or no. Would you think it would get to number one?
A band now that haven't had a single out for 2 years. They've taken a track off the forthcoming LP, Quadrophenia, I think it's called, and it's 5:15, and it's The Who!
The thing about 5:15 was that it was a soundtrack riff. You know, we were just getting the sound together, and then we moved on to another song, but we were just riffing away.
Why should I care? Why should I care?
This song is built around this riff coming up. And then the horns complement that.
If I go back and play you what John plays, you can hear that he plays an emulation of the guitar. He's playing my guitar part for me. With the drone in, which I always had in the background.
Are 15.
Sexually knowing.
The ushers are sniffing.
Eau de Cologne.
And the ushers are sniffing. Eau de Cologne was a reference to the young girls at the Beatles concert in Blackpool. The whole of Blackpool, this Blackpool theatre smelt of urine. I mean, it was just beyond belief. Every single girl in the audience must have pissed themselves in excitement. And they were sprinkling Eau de Cologne on all the seats, because it was apparently what you do, is you sprinkle Eau de Cologne.
Girls are 15, sexually knowing. The ushers are sniffing Eau de Cologne. The seats are seductive, celibate sitting. Pretty girl, dig it, pretty women. Magically born on a quiet street corner. Breed frustration in our minds and our toes. Quiet storm.
Jimmy's fallen out of love with his idols, he's been thrown out of his home, the scooter's been crashed. Right, now what do you do? If this is the going off into the wilderness, because actually what he's doing is he's going off in search of Xanadu. He's going back to find the thing that makes sense to him, you know, being on the beach, being down in Brighton, being part of the whole mod culture thing.
Light on the brain on the fire, 15.
And he's going off in search of something that he already knows is gone. That, I think, is why that song is so powerful, because it's the sense that something has already been lost. Goes back to Brighton, but there's that lovely idea that Townshend captures, a very English idea of going to a seaside town after the fair's left. You're off season. But actually there's a strange beauty in it, and the beauty is that he feels calm by the sea and the sand because everything else has passed away.
Here by the sea and sand, nothing ever goes as planned. I just couldn't face going home. It was just a drag.
Jimmy is drawn to, and this is the reason why he's not the same as everyone else, is that he goes and talks to the sea. The image of him looking out at something much bigger than all of this. Brighton, the mod culture thing is happening behind him here on the promenade, on the pier, but actually what he's doing is looking out at the vast expanse of the sea, and the sea is speaking to him.
Let me flow into the ocean. Let me get back to the sea. Let me be stormy and let me be calm. Let the tide in and set me free.
That was a song written about the spiritual journey.
I wanna drown. And I'm high up there fishing.
It's about let me get back to the sea, let me get back to the ocean, meaning let me get back to God. Which is brought on by walking on the beach, by the sea. There's nobody there but him. He's on his own.
Let me flow into the ocean. Let me get back to the sea. Let me be stormy and let me be calm. Let the tide in rush over me. You know I wanna drown, 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 drown. I wanna drown, 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 drown.
It's interesting that out of that calm and peace comes the story's whole turning point, where Jimmy meets up with this key figure from his past, the leader of the mods, the Ace Face. The idea is that Jimmy goes back and he finds this character who, you know, the Ace Face, who he really, really idolised. But in fact, the guy who was smashing in the hotel doors with him just recently is now working as a bellboy.
Sees his hero in the harsh midday sun being nobody.
When I see a face coming through the haze, I remember him from those crazy days.
And if this person who was so exalted, who was so perfect that he idolized, is nothing, then Jimmy has nothing. He is nothing.
Riding up in front of 100 faces.
Jimmy's rank disillusion at the idea that the person that he idolized is a fucking bellboy.
I've got a good job and I'm newly born. You should see me dressed up in my uniform. I work in a hotel, all gilt and flash. Remember the gap where the doors we smashed? Bellboy, I've got a gap.
It was quite difficult working with Keith as a singer because he acted rather than sang.
Carry the bloody baggage out!
Bellboy,
always running at someone's heel.
I love the way he did that.
You know how I...
It's the kind of thing you can imagine a bellboy doing, you know, working at a posh hotel. Got blimey like this with his mates, and then when it's after a tip, it's, hello, sir.
I was uncomfortable with turning the bellboy into a comedy figure because I thought, you know, this is the only time that the Ace Face sings.
Remembering when stars were green. I wander in early to work.
A couple of times just said to him, it's not a comedy.
Spend my day licking boots for my perks.
Whew, that would have gone.
Beach is a place where a man can feel. It's the only soul in the world that's real.
What was Keith like in 1973?
Just a little bit more drunk than he was in 1972.
LAUGHTER
the extraordinary thing about Keith was, so whatever you felt about him as a drummer, and I didn't think very much of him as a drummer. It's kind of sacrilege, isn't it? But I didn't. He listened.
People would call him sloppy drummer, and he never was a sloppy drummer. He had an extraordinary metronome. He made the music dramatic.
What he wouldn't do is play boom, boom, ba, ba, boom, ba, boom, boom, you know, bing, 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 bing,
When I look in your eyes, you could learn a lot from a life like mine. The secret to me, it ain't flown like a flag. I wear it behind this bloody little badge. What's that?
He was at top of his game in 73, 74. Absolute top of his game. He was magnificent. And funny as hell.
You know, I tell the funny stories about him showing up and saying, come outside and look at my new car. And we go out and there'd be a Rolls Royce and say, oh, it's fabulous, Keith, great. And then, you know, 2 hours later, we'd have from somebody from Jack Barclays. Where do I send the invoice for Keith Moon's new car? He said, I've got to send it to the Who Group. Is it the Who Group? I said, no, you send it to Keith Moon. No. We have to send it to the Who Group. And I said, no, we're not fucking paying for it, OK? You know, this is his car. Let him pay for it. No, you don't understand. No, you don't fucking understand. We're not paying for his car.
Ah, that's better.
I think today you'd say he had ADHD and he needed some Ritalin or something.
Hello, Keith.
But taking cocaine and Mandrax and brandy was exacerbating it.
It was always a mixture with Keith, you know, fun one minute and a bit frightening the next. And I never felt afraid of him, but frightened for him and people around him. And he wasn't at his best as a human being at that time. I don't know that any of us were, really. I shouldn't really single him out.
There's a credit on the inside of the sleeve which says Quadrophenia in its entirety by Pete Townshend.
Townshend writes, records the entire album himself in demo form, and then when he brought it to The Who, they did it again.
Quadrophenia was definitely like a Pete Townshend solo project. It was all Townshend from start to finish, his own, you know, and they probably knew nothing about it till he came and said, here it is, sort of thing. So you could see how Roger and maybe the others would feel a little bit resentful because it could be construed as being used like session musicians, you know.
Because I hear it said that Pete produced the album, which in a sense he did, but the one thing he never ever produced was the vocals. He's never there when I record my vocals, ever. I won't have that.
Roger was always tough, assertive, masculine. So there was always that sense that, you know, you had to be careful what you said around him. You really did.
Pete's a very complicated character, very incredibly complicated, as you can see by the songs he writes.
They had an addiction to friction. It's almost like they're two jigsaw pieces, and when you bring them together, they fit together. It's an absolute love-hate, not hate, but it's a love-anger relationship. And I think if you take away the love-anger, you take away the creative source, you take away the driving dynamic.
So he steals a boat in the story. and goes out to sea and almost drowns. It's clearly written as is this going to be what happens to this boy whose life's kind of fallen apart, who's kind of twice schizophrenic, pilled out, lost his, got nothing, doesn't have a girl, doesn't have a bike, doesn't have anything. And that's kind of what we're shooting. And then he's now really adrift. And then this, which I just kind of love. Love Rain or Me.
Only love. And what's interesting about the opening here is that what you hear from Roger is incredible tenderness. You know, you don't hear the heartfelt bawling, screaming bear that you hear later on.
Only love can make it rain the way the beach is kissed by the sea. Only love can make it rain like the set of lovers laying in the fields.
Then you get this impassioned scream.
If nothing else, Love Rain or Me shows that Jimmy's a man. A boy wants to be noticed at a club, wants a jacket. Here at the end, Jimmy is finally becoming a man and asking for things that men want.
Jimmy is the hero at last. It's not about the Who, it's not about Roger, it's not about Pete, not about John, it's not about the Mods, it's not about Ace Face, it's not about drugs or any of that stuff. It's just about Jimmy and what it is that he's finally got to is that he realises that he's been looking outside himself, and what he has to do now is to try to ask a question internally, and that's what the song does. No! For me was that as a composer, working with The Who was so great because they used to give me this unbelievable license. They didn't share my spiritual beliefs. Well, that's fine. They didn't share my spiritual beliefs, but they allowed me to have them, and they allowed me to express them through my work. And when it came to a song like Love Rain on Me, which is a spiritual prayer to nothing and everything, Roger gave it his bollocks.
Yeah, this is Roger coming in a second.
I did it as a scream from the street. I wanted it to be like the ultimate anger, the ultimate passion, the ultimate orgasm, you know. I wanted it to be like every emotion we've ever had.
No!
Because then it's unconditional to the track. And love should be always unconditional.
Yeah, you get a sense of Roger producing this deep scream from his heart, from Jimmy's heart.
Quadrophenia is left ambiguous. The illusion of drowning and water is throughout the album, and that can be death or a rebirth.
The question of what happens to Jimmy next I really like the fact that it's in the hands of the listener.
We're going to go on the road again. We're doing a tour of Europe. Then we do America. And we come back to Europe, and then we do America again. We've got two American tours lined up.
The day that we finished the stereo mix, our manager's booked a fucking tour. So I had 2 weeks to rehearse, to develop the stage quadraphonic sound, which was impossible. We didn't have the time. So they overworked us.
I didn't take into account properly at that time the load that Pete had, what with the mixing and everything else. I was trying to help them survive.
Speaking for myself, I was dead meat. Actually completely exhausted. I'm sure Roger was exhausted too.
We had employed a bunch of people that were our friends to film the rehearsal. And we played through, I think we got through to Dr. Jimmy. And they'd been sitting on their boxes with cameras. And I just say to them, you're going to sit on your fucking arses all afternoon, because, well, I'm not doing this, singing this again. I thought you were supposed to be filming this. I don't know why, but for some reason, this other side of Pete came over and started poking me. They'll do what I tell them to do. And doing this to me, all the roadies jump on me, and I start holding my arms.
I started to scream at him, and I can't remember the details, but we ended up in a physical grappling, and
he pulled his guitar off, and as he brought it down, he tried to hit me on the head with it, and it glanced off my shoulder, like that. Then he threw a punch, and it went one way, and went moved that way. Then he threw the other punch, and as he was coming forward with his right hand this way, I uppercutted him.
And he hit me, and I passed out.
At the shows, you could see they'd introduced our new work, and the audience were going, yeah, and it was starting.
We'd like to carry on our present act with our new album, or parts of it.
I don't know what they expected, but the audience, it was new to them.
And then what started to happen is that Roger started to tell the story.
This one's about his feelings when he gets down to the seaside.
Every time we played a song, he would stop me and say, well, nah, Jimmy is, you know, fucked off with his dad. He's going to go and get a job.
The next song is about a guy, and he sees an old gang leader who's working as a bellhop.
When somebody's talking on stage, you can't hear it. Half the time, you're next to the person, what did he say? So you had that confusion going on at these Quadrophenia shows.
So I probably gave Pete a load of problems he didn't need.
After that, things fell apart. It's the first night of the Quadrophenia US shows, and Moon takes elephant tranquilizer. And he starts off strong enough, and a few songs in, and he collapses.
He's out cold. I think he's gone and eaten something he shouldn't have eaten, like it's your foreign food. Yeah, I'm afraid the horrible truth is that without him, we're not a group.
Yeah, I kind of did that kind of thing all the time. It's just that this time it was, you know, the drugs were too powerful for him.
He is dragged off stage and they take a break and they come back and he makes it through, and then by the end of Won't Get Fooled Again, he's dead.
He is just, he's lifeless. He's jello.
Can anybody play the drums?
And then they had this fan, Scott Halpin, come and play drums with them.
Scott!
And that's how they kicked off what already was a difficult tour.
We managed to kind of soldier on. You know, we could put a brave face on it, and, you know, I could tell funny stories about it, and we could all have a good laugh. It was tragic, you know. It was really tragic because Keith was being a fool. We got good reviews and the album sold well. But when we came back to Europe the following year, we weren't even playing it. Went back to playing Tommy. And what's interesting about this album is it kind of worked. You know, we never really ever made a truly great album again. You pulled this letter out. It's a painful letter, but this is the man I was at a point. Ted Oldman was our lawyer at the time, and in this last week of recording here, I think I just thought, I've had it with this. This is not going to happen. We're not going to get an album. We're screwed in some way. I probably had a bad day, but it says, "Dear Ted, I'm writing to you in strictest confidence to ask advice and to seek guidance on a matter I feel only you can help me with. I've spoken to my wife and very intimate friends about this, but I found the making of this current record a great strain. The studio building problems, the writing problems, and of course, Kit and Keith have been aggravations to an already difficult time. I've been building up to this for many years now, and I feel that as of now, the record we are making and the current tours we're undertaking will be the last I want to be involved with The Who as a group. I'm losing any impetus either to write for The Who as a vehicle or play with its members of as a musician. You know, we were done. We were definitely done. And this letter is indicative of the fact that, you know, I would have gone home in that week and taken my wife aside and just said, you know, we haven't had a holiday for fucking 2 years. I've hardly seen you. We probably haven't made love for 6 weeks, 6 months, God knows what. You know, I probably missed you at Christmas. I probably missed our anniversary. I'm sorry. It was all a fucking complete waste of time. That's probably what I would have said to her. And she probably would have said to me, well, if that's how you feel, you should stop, sweetheart. And I write this letter and I didn't send it.
Let me get back to the sea.